Welcome to Future Takes, a series where we ask people for their views on achieving a more reconciled island of Ireland in the years ahead. Owen Reidy, General Secretary of the Irish Congress of Trade Unions, it's great to talk to you. So you grew up in Inishowen in County Donegal, and I wondered how that experience of growing up there, because it's a place apart, how has that shaped you?
I think it's shaped me quite significantly in that, I grew up in the 70s and 80s and early 90s in Donegal. Inishowen is a place apart. It has a huge connection with Derry City in particular. I always felt growing up that that part of the world was ultimately one community, a very diverse community, but one place, notwithstanding the fact that you had customs checkpoints and borders and things like that manifested physically. My mother's from Derry City. My grandfather was from Derry City. He was actually president of the Irish Congress of Trade Unions the year I was born, so there's a lovely symmetry there, and he was a big influence on my life.
Mm. And what has that perspective brought to your work with the Irish Congress of Trade Unions?
You see, it's a lovely symmetry again, because we are an all-island body. We've 760,000 members, 210,000 in Northern Ireland, the rest in the Republic, and we're truly cross-community. That's something I'm incredibly proud of. I think we're probably one of the largest truly cross-community organisations on the island. I think the fact that the Congress stayed together during the Troubles, during Brexit, suggests to me that that ethos of being pluralistic, representing everybody who's a worker, whether they are British, Irish, Northern Irish, some of the above, none of the above, and of course workers who call Ireland their home, who've come from other parts of the world, that's something I'm incredibly proud of, that diversity, that plurality, and I think that cultural diversity makes us richer and better.
What unique perspective do you think your work with the ICTU gives in terms of reconciliation?
I think trade unionists, worker activists, or shop stewards have huge skill set in conflict resolution and in representing diverse people and representing people maybe with different perspectives and different interests. In some ways, I think the trade union movement in Ireland is a microcosm of the concept of shared island. I think we've actually been doing it for 100 years,
Yeah, the mechanisms are there. But what about the meeting of minds?
I think we need to look at this in a multi-layered way. You'll remember in Northern Ireland over the last 2 years, because of the Tory cuts and because of stagnation, we had a lot of industrial action, a lot of disputes. On those picket lines right across Northern Ireland, you would have had people who voted for the DUP to Sinn Féin, everything in between and beyond. But what were they united on? They were united on wanting a fair day's pay, and they were united on getting justice for their colleagues to get a proper pay rise after 14 years of stagnation. So the fact that maybe some people supported Cliftonville and others supported Linfield or Celtic or Rangers, those things don't really matter. There are other things that bind people together. And I think it's about seeing people in a kind of a multi-layered way rather than a kind of a stereotypical one-dimensional way and putting people in boxes. We have many different identities. And for some people, some of those identities are fluid. And I think we need to be accepting of that, relaxed about that, confident about that, and curious about that. And I think we'll all be the richer for it.
You've spoken a lot about North-South and the mechanisms on the island. What about East-West relationships? Where do they come into play in terms of the future take of this island?
I think they're crucially important. And I think we saw that at the start. When the Good Friday Agreement was signed, we decided to set up a Council of the Isles. So the Northern Ireland Committee of the Irish Congress, the Irish Congress, the Welsh TUC, the Scottish TUC, and the TUC, the English TUC, we meet every year. Sometimes it's in Belfast, Dublin, Glasgow, Cardiff, and London, and we meet with our colleagues. I have much more in common with a British trade unionist than I have with someone in Ireland who votes for the new populist right, whether they're north or south. The relationships on these islands, we have an inextricable link despite recent political history because of our history. And whilst that history has been challenging, and whilst it has been one of colonialism, we have to learn from it, reflect it, and have good neighbourly relations as we go forward. I think that can only make us richer culturally. Look at the amount of people from this island that make Britain their home, and look at the amount of people from Britain who make this island their home. And obviously in Northern Ireland, the people who consider themselves British, Irish, and Northern Irish. So there's a rich cultural heritage there. We all come from different aspects of it, but I think we should learn about the other and celebrate it and not see it as something to fear, not see it as something that's a threat. I'm Irish. I have an Irish passport. That doesn't mean that I have any concerns or worries or fears or discomforts about colleagues of mine who consider themselves British. That's great, that's no problem.
Let's pick up on the issues of respect and identity. Do you think they go hand in hand?
Very much so. You know, if you want respect, you have to give it. But you should also expect that respect in return. It has to be win-win. The future of this island, whatever its constitutional configuration is, and, you know, I'm very relaxed about that because the people will decide. But whatever happens, it has to work for everybody. Everybody has to feel that they have a stake in the society. I read a really good article from one of our colleagues in the Belfast Telegraph a couple of months ago, Paul McFlynn from the Nevin Economic Research Institute. And he made a point that I'm going to make for the next number of years everywhere I go. And he basically said, if you're in Northern Ireland and you want constitutional change, it's in your interest that Northern Ireland works, that it functions, and that it's successful. If you're in Northern Ireland and you want the constitutional status quo, it's in your interest that Northern Ireland works and that it's successful. There's something that everybody can unite on.
To sum up, what specific ideas would you have to give the powers that be to inspire them to make this a better island for everyone?
See, I wouldn't give it to the powers that be. I think part of the problem is power has been reluctantly shared by some parties, but power hasn't been shared with civil society. The trade union movement, the employers, the farmers, the community and voluntary sector. There's no meaningful social dialogue in Northern Ireland. In the Belfast Good Friday Agreement, it was supposed to be a civic forum, it was supposed to be a Bill of Rights. Those things haven't been done yet. You look at Europe and you look at societies that work, every group feel that they have a stake, that they have a say, and that they are being listened to. We need that in Northern Ireland, and we need more of it in the Republic of Ireland. So I think what the powers that be need to do is they need to share power with civic society. I would love to see a situation where you've got strong social dialogue in Northern Ireland, strong social dialogue or stronger in the Republic of Ireland, parallel social dialogue when the North-South Ministerial Committee meet, and East and West. Because if you do not bring those that create employment and those that represent workers in employment together on that journey, you're missing out something fundamental. The bottom line is, everyone who calls this island home, however they define themselves, has to have the right to have a full life, both in work and beyond work.
Owen Reidy, it's been great to talk to you. Thank you.
Thanks.